30, baby, won't you meet me by the bean? Too early, maybe later, you could show me things. You know what it is whenever I visit Windy City, she blowing me kisses, no. 30 degrees, way too cold, so hold me tight. Will I see you at the show tonight? Will I see you at the show tonight?
Ay. Truck to the plane, to the truck, truck to the hotel lobby. Me, I go through underground garages, presidential suite on deposit. Elevator up to the room, shower up and then we hit the club. Touchdown, gotta see what's up. Area code in my phone, what numbers do I still have? Who do I know from the past? Hit one, she say she got a man.
Barnimal, how has your trading been lately? How you been doing?
Pretty good. The past, I guess, 4 or 5 weeks, I've been doing pretty well. Started 2022 like most people, kind of struggling a little bit, just like not what we're used to. I mean, I've been doing pretty well until, I guess, like mid-December, and then I was doing on vacation and stuff for the most of the time. Now doing well, making back a lot of gains, and I'm pretty much green on the year now. So, it's been kind of a roller coaster, especially like doing this full time. So it's like, you gotta be more careful and less, I guess, take less risks, but you can still, Yeah.
Like the moment where you switch over, it's like, well, now this is it. Like,
yeah.
I'm kind of stuck making money, or if I don't make money, then oh shit.
Yeah. You're screwed. But yeah, that's part of it. When I went full time, I like made sure I had enough in the bank to where I could take some losses if I needed, or if I did, and then be okay. But
yeah. How are you? How you feeling about this market? I know it's like you said, it's been a roller coaster. I mean, pennies have been heating up a bit, which you're a small cap guy, but how are you feeling?
Right now it feels like we're kind of getting that January, February effect just later on. I've felt really comfortable. It's felt like, I guess, last year, February, when the Oilers ran last week, that was pretty GameStop style type kind of craziness, which was awesome. And that's where I like took full advantage of it. And I think I tweeted like 2 weeks before that, I was like, you just got to strike when this shit's hot.
INDO just went freaking, what did it go from, like $5 to 60 or 70 or something like that?
Yeah, it was like, it was three, then I got some news, and then it went to nine, then came back down to five, consolidated for a bit, and then went just crazy. I mean, I had been trading in and out of it. I was like, this is going to go at some point, kind of crazy, because oil kept going up. I was like, this has a chance, but I didn't have the conviction to hold on to it all the way up.
Yeah.
So I was just scalping the smaller ones, sympathies. It's kind of my favorite thing to do.
I think Tony and I both, didn't we both trade HUSA, H-U-S-A? I can't remember if you did.
Yeah, bro, that's when I grabbed HUSA and I went to the doctor and didn't even look at it. And then I walked out of the doctor and it was like $14.
My God. That's a good doctor's visit. Yeah. Huh?
I saw it gap up pre-market. Yeah, dude. I saw it gapped up pre-market and it was already on my watch list. I think that was a Monday and it was on my watch list for Sunday. So I'd been watching it, but I never will grab something if I'm leaving my setup. But I basically took a lotto, something that I was just willing to, you know, lose 50% of it. Because when I was at the doctor and getting x-rayed, I couldn't end on my phone, and I left the doctor.
And he yanked it out in the x-ray machine.
Yeah.
started fucking scalping options in the x-ray machine.
It was crazy, but didn't we get that 3-day effect? Remember we were talking about that, Teddy? I think we got that 3-day effect on a bunch of those Oilers.
The T plus two.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I love those setups. Those are my favorite.
Mm-hmm. But we were talking about that.
Yeah.
I think they went again.
We talked. Yeah. It was last podcast. I think we talked about, it's coming up tomorrow or something.
Yeah. It was with Herb.
Yeah. Herb's the man.
Oh, we love Herb.
He's big into those. Yeah, yeah.
Herb's like, when I think of like a kind of like a surgical trader, I feel like Herb is like a surgical trader. I feel like he like has no emotions. Like he's just like, I will buy now. And then he buys, and then when it goes up, he's like, I think I will sell. And he sells, and like no emotions go into it. Yeah. Which that's kind of like, that's kind of what you want. You
have to
I
be
guess.
Like that, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, you gotta cut out the emotions. That's a huge thing that I've been learning.
So, do you only trade small caps, or you...
I'm small caps, but I mean, I'll monitor SPY, QQQs, some large caps, and trade options on those when small caps aren't doing well.
Mm-hmm.
That was a big part of like February for me. It was really learning kind of SPY action. I mean, I obviously monitored it for like the time I've been investing trading. But especially February, January, when my thing to really trade. So I'll trade that every once in a while.
Yeah.
That's what me and Tony have done. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, like, when you have the ability to do both, it's just, I mean, you essentially can do anything. If there's a day that pennies are hot, you can trade pennies. If there's a day, there's really nothing that looks good. You can, you know, trade whatever, you know, Qs, SPY, whatever it is. So
yeah,
that's the benefit of that.
Yeah, learning how to trade everything's huge, and I mean, obviously having specialties is good, but if you can kind of get that full arsenal, you're really set. Especially like if you're doing what I'm doing, like full-time trading, it's, you got to kind of try to master everything in case.
Yeah,
if market changes, you got to be able to adapt.
Yeah, improvise, adapt, overcome.
Yeah, I gotta ask, what's the tweet on your wall?
Oh shit, that was when I first hit $1 million in my account. My friends, it was for my wedding. It was a wedding gift. My friends put that on a metal board and gave it to me as like as my wedding present. So I was like, oh shit, that's so thoughtful.
That's awesome.
Like, this is awesome. But yeah,
those are some good friends right there. Damn.
Yeah. Yeah.
Super cool.
Just hung it up in my office.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I got to ask too. Today was FOMC. We had Powell talk. Mm-hmm. What did you guys kind of take from that? We'll start with you, Bonimo, and then we'll head over to Tony. But what did you guys take away from it, other than, you know, the obvious, the rate hike and that kind of stuff?
We knew it was going to be a 25 point or basis point hike. I mean, I saw people on Twitter saying yesterday, like, oh, it could go to like 50, 75. It's like, usually what the Fed says for the past, I don't know, two years, they've pretty much done what they're going to, like, what's expected. So I wasn't expecting anything more. So, but the GDP number was kind of scary, projecting out how we're going to be losing GDP. I was talking to Incredible Bob about that today, and he was like, yeah, that was the biggest takeaway from the FOMC. Like, that's kind of scary stuff. But I guess we're going to have, like, what, six more?
That's what I was going to say, is the fact that there's going to be six more of those. And what this was the first increase since what? 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 2018, I think.
Yeah, that sounds right.
So
this is gonna be a market that a lot of people aren't like used to, I guess, or like a economic environment that a lot of traders, especially new guys that started in COVID or whatever, are gonna experience. So we'll
then we had that. Yeah, it was crazy. I mean, the action, we flushed right at 2 o'clock for like 15, 20 minutes, and then
rip, baby.
Yeah, dip and rip.
The ultimate dip and rip.
That was ridiculous.
It was more like knife and rip. It was just the worst fucking knife. And then I'm pretty sure if you go look at like the hourly, it's just like a massive tweezer bottom. Like, it's like a huge ass candle, Clifford dick, and then it's a shrek boner right afterwards.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Did y'all straddle any SPY options or anything?
I had a guy in my Discord who did, but I did not.
I didn't.
We were done at what, noon? Because we traded together today around like noon.
Yeah, we traded and got out of there, dude.
I had somebody message me about. Oh, wait, you saw. Remember I linked you that somebody took like $30 million worth of SPY calls that expire Friday?
somebody knew.
When I saw it
behind that,
when I saw it falling off a cliff, I'm like, that dude's fucked. But
yeah, that's
apparently not. Apparently he's not.
Iron balls right there. He was like, he probably held through that. He was like, oh, it's dipping, it ain't nothing, and then rips right up.
Yeah, that was ridiculous.
And it's funny, during that entire thing, I was trading small caps today. I mean, they're because they've been doing well, but nothing really was, none of my holdings or anything that I was trading was impacted, which was nice. But yeah, it was a nuts move.
What was the penny play you traded today, Teddy?
Oh, SONN.
SONN.
SONN, yeah, that had like 300 mil volume today.
Damn, I like that, ripping out the volume numbers.
That's solid. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, pay attention to these because I'm waiting for the next one, the sympathies to start hitting.
And I traded SON in the worst possible way. I held it for like, how long was that, Tony? Like 4 hours? For 4 hours, and it like fake broke out like four times while I was holding it, and it like trapped me like four times. Like I was like, oh, this is the breakout, and then it didn't break out, and then so I sold because it like failed below 9 EMA and 20 EMA, and then it ripped right afterwards to like 40% upside. Like it was like I had like a good average, and oh, it was terrible. But
it's a tough one to trade historically.
Yeah, it was a bitch today. That is for certain. Mm-hmm. I think for me, FOMC was kind of them ripping the Band-Aid off finally. Like,
yeah,
I know that they said they were going to do the rate hike, but then, you know, like you said, the GDP numbers came out, which was a little frightening. And then they said six more possible. That's just the Band-Aid feeling like it got ripped off. And then I thought that we were going to continue downside today. I really didn't expect it to bounce back like it did. Which I don't think anyone did expect that fully, but I just thought it was crazy. I just couldn't believe like the fact that they said we're going to have six more and the GDP numbers were bad. I was honestly flabbergasted. I got back to my computer about the start of Power Hour and I was like, what is going on?
Yeah.
What is this?
It was like a kind of a sell the anticipation by the news to an extent. I mean, over the past week, I guess.
You know how many people went chasing that flush and got absolutely fucked? Like a lot. Yeah. I had somebody today message me and was like, oh, I got destroyed. And I said, but like, what was the point of trade? Like, you knew I posted 10 times about FOMC at 2 p.m. yesterday and today. I posted over and over. I'm like, people. Be prepared. You know, if you're holding anything into it, it's a risk, complete risk. It's just like some people just like completely ignore it, and then they get upset when they lose money. But like, it's a complete gamble.
That's it. I always tell people treat it as a lotto or have a hedge. Like,
I almost grabbed spy calls, because I saw that $30 million order come in. That expired Friday. I'm like, oh shit, somebody knows something. And I almost grabbed some, and I like said, I'm like, listen, I don't suggest doing this. I'm willing to lose this. I held off, but some people just, I don't know. I don't know why. Like, I don't know why you would, you know, hold something into that, not realizing the risk potential. So I don't know.
Yeah.
But, I had a question for you. We like to ask questions like that can help new traders out. We try to cater this towards newer beginner traders. So I have a couple questions, but the first one I have would be, what do you think for you was your biggest hurdle to overcome before you really started to be like consistent and successful?
A lot of it was like emotion. Mm-hmm. I was used to be a very emotional trader when I was starting out. I started investing like in college and stuff. I'm like 28 now, but full-time or trading for three years, I guess, ish. But emotion and falling in love with plays and not knowing when to take losses. And the hardest thing is not letting those losses get too big. No matter what, like you believe about the company, you can always reposition. But yeah. I guess that was always my biggest thing. I always believed in companies and whatever, and it's hard to do that and be successful.
Yeah, because you could have a 40% win rate and be extremely, extremely successful if you're, you know, cutting losers quickly and winners run and stuff like that.
Something, dude, I think we need to talk more about, like, at some point, maybe in a future episode, about how to take losses. I feel like that's something that's really, really understated on, like,
so many people struggle with that.
Yeah, like, that's the thing that I've noticed the most with the people in, like, our Discords, the beginners, is they'll be like, okay, well, I don't know when to cut. And it all comes to, like, the setup. Like, when does the setup change from, you know, you're thinking it's bullish, and then all of a sudden, you know, if it, you know, knifes and then knifes with volume and then confirms under something, like, all that stuff, like, plays into it. But that's something that I think a lot of people struggle with. They just hold because they're like, well, it's got to come back up eventually, or, well, my setup, it's still kind of there, like that kind of stuff, which those are all things that are going to get you absolutely ran into the ground.
Yeah, exactly. And I've taken huge losses in the past, and that's, I mean, you do learn when you do take those losses. Like, when you take the loss, it's not, I mean, it is a loss, but it's also like, shit, this is a learning experience. I need to get my shit together and not do this again. And
yeah.
So that's, I mean, I guess I learned a lot that way.
Yeah. And that's the thing, like, if you continue doing the same thing, that's why I always tell people, like, I can't recommend journaling your trades enough when you first start, so you can, like, really identify, you know, if you are holding on to losers too long and that's a reoccurring problem. But if you continue to make that same mistake over and over and you're not fixing it, I don't know, like, due to selfishness, due to, you know, just not putting enough work in, you're going to just blow a count up over and over and over, and eventually you're going to give up. You're just going to be done with it. You're going to have lost, you know, X amount of money. And
dark in here quick. Holy crap.
Well, it's the truth. It's the truth. It really is
the truth. I actually agree. Like, not enough people say that. Is like, if you keep doing everything that's, like, people are telling you not to do,
yeah,
like, you're going to fail.
Yeah. Nope. For sure. Exactly. I had another question. I know you trade full time. How did that transition from, you know, whatever job you're working to going full time? How was that? And what was your biggest struggle with that? I actually had somebody in my group ask me that today because they've been thinking about going full time. I told them, I'm like, dude, when you think you're ready, it's a whole different thing once you actually do it, because, like, you know, if you're quitting a job and then dependent on that, it's a whole different, you know, psychological. Yeah.
Well, the hardest thing, I mean, I guess you're kind of, once you go full time, it's like survival instincts kick in and you're more aggressive. Well, you're more aggressive with like trying to make, like, you're not, I don't like being red, like, and I wouldn't mind being red when I had my salary. And so, I don't know. I feel like it's a lot being able to get screen time and, like, actually watch things transpire. Cause I was pretty busy at my old job and I would just swing things, and that started to, like, stop working. But once you started to get, like, screen time and, being able to watch things throughout the day, that really opened my eyes. And I was more, I mean, I guess going back to the whole taking losses quicker, that was, became part of my thing. And, but I guess the biggest struggle was just realizing I had to do this full time and make money because this is my full time job. And it's the whole, like, I guess, psychological thing.
Yeah,
and I have a wife and dog, and so it's like you got to continue to do this and perform. So you can, I don't know, your mindset changes a lot, but I was glad, like, I had enough money in my account to where I was able to be able to take a few losses, but it was just a whole psychological change.
Yeah,
but I love it. It's the best thing of life. Like,
It's such a weird thing, because, like, I'll have people that'll be like, you never really want to, like, you know, feel like you're being rude or disrespectful to anybody, but I'll have people that'll be like, oh, I had, like, a really good, two real good weeks in a row. I'm like, that's not going to do it. You can't be wanting to quit your job because you had two consistent weeks. You know, you have $1,000 in your account.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just not going to work.
I always tell people, have, like, at least 6 months of like rent saved up, whatever like life expenses saved up. And then I also tell people, have a year of consistent having green months, at least that. Like, that's the bottom line, in my opinion.
And being able to trade any market, any market.
Any market.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, there's people that have reached out to me that have been trading for, I don't know, like less than a year that want to go full time. But it's like, you don't know. If you haven't done this for at least like a year or two plus, you don't really know how to, like, you haven't seen all the cycles.
Exactly.
Because, like, and that's a huge part of it, because I've been doing this for a little while, so I've been able to, like, kind of see a lot of different things, so I know what to expect when things aren't great.
Yeah.
Which I guess, right, like, past four, kind of the small caps haven't been great, so, but I was still able to, like, manage. But yeah, you gotta have some experience, and
You can't only trade one way too. Like, if you only, if you're a swing trader, you know, and that's all you know, and that's all you've ever done. What the hell have you been doing for the past 8 months?
Yeah,
exactly. Like,
you got to be able to see those, like, those little changes and adapt. Like, a few weeks ago or a month or two ago, I was talking to Incredible Bob quite a bit, and we were like, man, these pennies feel like they're like on the bottoms right now. Yeah. They're kind of like getting ready. And then, like, lo and behold, the past, like, maybe month, pennies have been heating up quite a bit. But you got to, like, know those indicators beforehand. Mm-hmm. And if you've only been trading for, like, months or maybe 1 year, you're not going to know when those pennies are beginning to heat up or when, you know, it's time to switch to large caps instead of pennies. Earning seasons, you have no idea about any of that. You have no idea about what happens when SPY pulls back more than 10%. You know, all these things, you just have to have time under your belt. Months of consistency, if not years of consistency. Yeah, it's all based on just time, experience, staring at a screen, seeing setup after setup, seeing market changes, all that kind of stuff over and over and over and over.
Yeah, you just have to really just experience the biggest thing, and the more you do it, the better you'll learn, and the more cycles you'll go through or whatever. And
I've told this story before, but I think it was October, beginning of October. I stopped putting swings out and started to transition to option watch lists. And people were getting mad at me. They're like, oh, why are you doing this? Blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, because there's nothing that indicates that, you know, there's any strength in the market. And if we're not able to adapt to the potential of, you know, an aggressive bear market into next year, potentially the entire year, what are we all going to be doing? We're all just going to be doing nothing. No one's going to be swinging. And if you're swinging, you're going to be losing money.
Exactly. I was swinging a little bit in, I don't know, January or December. Some of them worked, some of them didn't, but
yeah,
it was a toss up.
Exactly. And people get mad at me, but I mean, it is what it is.
I stop getting mad at everything nowadays, bro.
I can't do anything. I can't post a picture of what I'm eating for dinner. It's just like,
it's rough out there on the old FinTwit Wild West.
Yes, FinTwit is a Wild West right now, dude. It's crazy.
Well, that goes into my next. That segues into my next question. My last question. What do you feel about FinTwit at the moment?
Like, the good people have survived. The people that, I don't know, the people that are still posting ideas and motivation, or that are still there. I mean, that's what we got. Like, that's what we're working with going forward, and got to find the good people and follow them, and people that want to, that are willing to help. And there's a lot of that, but I mean, there's still, you see it all the time, but
it's starting to get weeded out though, which is
good about it lately. Like you were saying, it feels like some people have, like, a lot of people have begun to just kind of die off, and it's like, wow, they were really kind of more of the toxic people, and well, they're gone now. So, like, it feels like we're getting to the core.
They'll be back. They'll be back.
They'll be back.
When they, GME,
they always come.
Bullshit. There's always something.
When the market heats up, they'll be back.
Trump will have, like, a new, like, SPAC or something that goes, like, 8,000% again, just like last time.
So.
Me too, dude. Anything with his name, I'm just going to buy from now on. Like, the moment
I
hear anything about it. But
yeah.
Barnimal, I gotta ask you, what do you like to do in your free time, man? What do we got with those hobbies? You like to play basketball? You like to watch football? What do you like to do?
I'd like to do both of those. I played basketball like in high school, college, or not college, but like rec and stuff in college, and I still do it now. Golfer. I golf a decent amount. Actually, I was at the
ever hit a hole in one.
I wish, dude, that would be sick. I was at the Waste Management Open like 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago. Or
whatever. Dude, so was my buddy. You know, Coke, really? Teddy. Coke was there.
Yeah, Tim.
Yeah, he was.
Oh,
wait, look.
His real name, Coke. Coke's. He was really there. Oh shit!
I got a little divot fixer.
Oh nice. Dude. Yeah, awesome. It was awesome. My buddy's bachelor party, but yeah,
that was probably fun.
Golfing. Yeah, it was a blast. But yeah, golfing.
Ready for March Madness?
Yeah, I made my bracket today. I picked Auburn just to throw things off. I'm an SEC guy, so.
I got Tennessee and Baylor. And actually Villanova. Ooh. I have three brackets.
You don't even watch basketball.
No, I don't watch basketball.
Neither do I.
I haven't watched a game in probably like 5 years, I'd bet.
Do you like the NBA?
I love the NBA.
Who's your team?
I'm from Dallas. I'm a Mavs guy.
Unfortunately a Sixers fan.
I don't want to flex on anybody, but I'm a Bucks fan.
Yeah, you are.
Oh, nice.
I got the hat in my closet. I'm going to have to put it on now that we just started talking about this. The Mavs
look good this year.
For like 5 years.
They do. I'm glad we got rid of Porzingis.
Yeah, he was. His attitude's horrible.
We got some good pieces for him.
Dinwiddie's good, yeah.
Luka's off the freaking
chain. So you're a Cowboys fan?
Cowboys, yeah. Right, we're off season.
Oh, boy.
Right now. yeah.
Well,
yeah. We'll see. I don't know. I hope we get Clowney or something. But
I didn't see you guys then go with Cooper.
Yeah, we needed to. We should have got. I mean, we wanted to get rid of Zeke, but nobody would take that contract.
Yeah.
So we had to get rid of Cooper.
Tony Pollard might be better than Zeke.
I think he is. Like, I'd rather have him.
I agree. Do you like Jerry Jones?
I do. I
think he's one of the like pieces that you guys got to get rid of in the future.
I agree. Yeah, I like him as a person, but not as a owner.
Yeah, he's way too involved. He's always like sticking his hands in things, yeah. And I've heard so many stories about him like deciding who they sign or like doing like contract stuff. And it's like, dude, you don't know that much about football.
Yeah,
leave it up to the GM, the coaches, but.
Yeah,
he is a good guy. I like a, if yeah, he was
exactly
if he was my team, I'd be like, oh man, dude, I kind of like this guy. I don't know what we should do.
Yeah,
I'd be like on the fence.
Yeah,
that's funny.
And then okay, man. So we talked earlier. You got a mini Australian Shepherd, and I like can't picture it in my head. How big is it?
You want me to get him?
Yeah.
Hold on. One second. Hey, Rebel, come here, buddy.
He's just fucking gigantic.
Dude, I imagined like a chihuahua-sized Australian Shepherd, no, like dude. A little like I mean like this big.
No, he's gonna be bigger than that. Aww.
Oh, dude.
Oh my god, he's so cute.
He's my he's Twitter so cute. Banner. But he's a good boy.
He looks like a good boy.
All right, go see mommy. Yeah, we got him like 2.5 years ago. When my wife and I kind of met, we got a dog pretty quick after. But yeah, he's the best.
My
Twitter banner.
My buddy just got one like 6 months ago. They're so cute.
They're smart dogs.
Yeah.
You have a lot of energy.
It's behind me when I trade. Tries to paw at me to give him his ball. I'm like, dude, hold on. Wait.
They're definitely, because my dog has a shit ton of energy too. She's a short-haired pointer, but.
Oh, nice.
I want an Australian Shepherd, if I'm being honest. My girl's always trying to get me to get a dog. And I'm always like, we have like three cats. We can't get a dog, blah, 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 blah. But dude, I kind of want an Australian Shepherd.
Yeah, they're cool.
They shed.
They're
do they cool. shed pretty good?
Yeah, he just shed on me. So.
Did he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's hot outside, so he's going through his coat. But yeah, he's the man.
What's his name? Rebel?
Rebel. Yeah.
It's a cool name.
Rebel is the man. Where did your name come from? Barnamal.
Barnamal. So this was a nickname I got in college. My last name is Barnes. So okay. If you like, oh, do you just go to the bars a lot? And I was like, well, yes, but but my friend, they just called me that in college, and then I kind of made it my Twitter name, and then it just kind of, I didn't change it. I was like, this is unique. Nobody.
How'd you get Thick Teddy?
Yeah.
Dude, I don't even know. Have I told that story before?
I don't think so.
Dude, I remember watching Bob's Burgers, like, just when I was extremely in the zone.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the zone, I mean, like, extremely blasted of some sort. And I just thought that Teddy was the funniest guy ever. Like, I think it was, like, they took him to some, like a pond or something, and he, like, couldn't catch a fish, and he was, like, running around going, "Why can't I catch fish?" And, like, I don't know, I just thought it was so funny. And then I was like, eh, Thick works because it's kind of funny. I'm kind of thick, both a little bit of both. I don't really know. So,
wait, how long did you have your Twitter for? How long have you had your Twitter?
I think I got mine in.
Because you've had Twitter way longer than I have.
Yeah, because we met before you even had Twitter. I think I got Twitter, like, maybe, like, right before the COVID crash, something like that.
Like, beginning of that year?
Yeah, like, right at the beginning.
Yeah. Was yours like a playoff Incredible Bob? Or
no, I'd never met Incredible Bob.
Oh, really? That's cool.
Yeah.
Now you guys are best friends.
We kind of met. Yeah. And now we're homies. It's kind of funny. He is the man, dude. We always talk about small caps and swings and stuff.
Yep.
Can you dunk a basketball?
Me?
Yeah.
I have dunked like a few times back when I was in high school, which is, I'm like 5'9", so...
Holy shit.
Barnamal coming,
you can really jump then.
Yeah.
Is you dunking over someone and then all of your friends going, "Barnamal!"
Yeah. Wait, did you hear what he said though? Did you hear what he said though? He's only 5'9" and can dunk?
Dude, that's how tall I am. I've never even touched the rim, I don't think.
That's crazy. That's actually crazy.
That is crazy.
Yeah.
That's some athletic hops. You could probably squat like 600 pounds or some crazy like that.
I haven't squatted. I broke my back twice in high school, so I haven't squatted since.
Playing football?
Like your back.
Yeah, football.
Football?
Yeah, so I've never squatted since freshman year of high school.
And I'll be honest, back. I'm gonna be very careful about my kids playing football, bro.
Yeah.
Football is actually so scary.
Dude, it is.
Yeah. CTE and all that shit. School. Yeah.
Yeah. These are like 17-year-old, 16-year-old kids. But
yeah, my wife and I are crazy. Like 2 or 3 years away from having kids, and I'm like, shit, I have to worry about this and then playing football. All right, but I do want him to play football, but still,
it's kind of sad now. I know the town I'm in, they like had to get rid of their little league program because there's just no kids want to do anything. Like, they'd rather be inside playing Fortnite and playing
video
on their I just think that's kind of sad, to be honest. I remember when I was in little league, it was like 10 teams. And now there's none. It's like, it's a little depressing.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's so weird.
Yeah, it's very strange.
All right, Barnamal. So we got a few minutes here. We want to talk about your favorite swing setups and your favorite scalp setups.
Yeah.
If they're particular, explain them. But if they're kind of just more general, then that's all right too.
I look at things in for my swing setups or scalp setups. It's kind of like I just know what to look for based on experience. But when I'm looking for like swings or something like that, I like to, for my small caps, something sitting pretty close to the 20 SMA. That's kind of my trigger line. If I see it curling up a little bit, then that'll be like, oh, okay, what's this? Why would this be a good swing or whatever? Look at all the, I like lower float on these things. I mean, some of this relates to large caps as well. But curling up, bottomed out near the 20 SMA, that's kind of my guide, I guess, for swings. And really just looking to see if something's found a true bottom or a support for my small cap swings. If it looks like it's still going down more, or looks like it's failing, then I wouldn't touch it. But if we get a nice curl and found a solid support, that's kind of my guide. And I really like bottom swings, bottom plays. That's my.
Finvis has a lot of real good parameters for things like that.
I was about to say FinViz is where I go to get like a lot of different things.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great website.
This is the
goat. I have it on my screen all day.
Yeah, FinViz is. The thing with FinViz is people don't want to put the work into like go comb through things like that. Go comb through, you know, 300 charts, but it's worth it.
That's key, bro.
It's totally worth it.
Definitely worth it. Yeah. If you love charts as much as you should, if you're a trader, like, I think homework is fun. Like, no.
Oh yeah, and then you find something and it works out, and you're like, I just did all that work, and it feels so good.
Sitting here for like an hour at night while my girlfriend's like, come to bed, and I'm like, I'm having fun.
Yeah, you're grinding on charts.
Don't worry, babe. I got FinViz right now. Dude, do you like the setups where it's like, it's a downtrend and then it just goes sideways for a few weeks with like low volume? Yeah.
Oh, you must have been talking to Incredible Bob.
I talk to him every day.
Oh, well.
He's
but
a
yeah,
beast,
he was telling me about that. But yeah, I love the frying pan bottoms. I love the falling wedges. Once we get, dude, these falling wedge breaks, I don't know, Cavill, Hook, recently Kala, KALA. They've had news that breaks them out of the falling wedge, this long falling wedge. And that'll drive like a multi-day move. Falling wedge over like a long falling wedge, those downtrend breaks are sometimes the biggest moves, and you can get multi-day things out of those.
Yeah, when something's bottomed for so long, eventually it gets to a point where it's like absolute minimal risk, like as humanly possible.
Yeah.
That's why I'm swinging FAMI right now.
Oh, you are?
Literally almost no risk.
Yeah, there's almost no risk. Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw that one get slapped like crazy after hours today when GLG ran. That was fun. Eventually that one will go, I promise. Not in it right
especially
now.
Especially Chinese, and then like we get some like food, and then everyone will start talking about, oh, they make mushrooms, that's food.
I thought that would have gone last week. I mean, I was playing food plays all last week. There were some sweet setups. But I was talking to somebody about it. I think I was talking to Stock Swing Alert and Ellis, Dellinger, a few other guys today. I was like, why didn't FAMI go last week? That should have been good.
I was confused too. I was waiting all of last week. I was like, today's the day. Today's the day. Agni's going. Everything is.
Yeah.
All right. So Barnimal, we've talked about FinViz being how you find your tickers. We've talked about you liking those downtrends, those falling wedges, all that kind of stuff. Those are good setups. What are a few terrible, bad setups that might be looking like good setups that you've seen beginners get trapped in?
It's a good one. A lot of beginners get trapped in chasing alerts. So buying when they see an alert or a news play, they see a spike and they'll be like, oh, that's going to go more. Doesn't always go more. A lot of times it's like BS. I never, unless I see a headline that's something meaningful, and I've learned this through experience and through like my mentors and everything and everybody I've talked to taught me about headlines. Unless I see something that's super meaningful, I'll wait for the thing to set up after the first spike, because a lot of the times there could be a good headline, and it also depends on the market you're in, but it could be a good headline, you slap the top and then you're stuck. I feel like as a rookie trader, you're most likely to try to chase some news or something and you don't know what it means, but it's going up, and that's where I got smoked when I was kind of really starting in the small cap world. And I guess it goes for large caps too, but when you see a big spike on a large cap, that's usually some meaningful news.
You know what I noticed that people get trapped in a lot is like something that's overextended, but maybe forming, you know, like if you're running all day and you get real, real overextended and exhausted, it may start forming like a wedge. Or the same way, you know, if something's in a downtrend all day, I see people get stuck in that all the time, and they don't really realize. They just think, oh, I see this formation, it's gonna play out. It has to play out. And that's just not, that just doesn't happen all the time, especially when
sometimes
something's exhausted.
Up, sometimes it'll be setting up perfectly and you won't check the volume, but the volume is actually fading and it'll be a breakout that you think it's going to go.
Yeah.
But then the volume's not there. And so you'll get the goalie pull stuff move right at high of daybreak. And then that is where you'll get smoked. And I've been there too.
Yeah. I see the more than people getting stuck in setups, I see people be hesitant more than getting stuck. In terms of like, I have a lot of people in my Discord now that I'm trying to help them with, like, Teddy, we talked about this, like, they want to fight the trend. Mm-hmm. They don't know how to just ride the trend. They see, you know, something's in an uptrend and it starts to pull back, mm-hmm. and they think, oh shit, now's my chance to go short, and it bounces off like a 9 EMA and then you just continue trend.
The huge was SPY. So I've noticed this year, SPY people have been like either staying bearish or staying bullish. And it's their mindset. They think it's going to be a bad day regardless. Like, this can't go up anymore. Yep. And they'll try to fight the trend and short every pop, and it'll keep popping on them. And that's huge. And going to what you're saying.
Yeah. It's like, or today we gapped up on the indices and I had people saying, oh, well, we're going to fill this gap down before the market opened. I'm like, why?
That's what I was about to talk about. It's the bias going into the day that I see everybody.
It's the biggest issue. It's the biggest issue.
Just stop. Just trade what's in front of you. If you see SPY and you think, oh, FOMC is here today, like, we're going to go down. Who said that?
Yeah.
Who did literally, like, Jesus Christ himself walk into your head and say, must go down on every
I think FOMC. This was the biggest day on SPY since 2020.
Really?
I didn't see that. It probably might have been
April 2020, I think. Day. Yeah, like,
wow.
I that's what I see, and then it's frustrating because, you know, it's just a mental thing. It's just a hurdle that you have to get over with, like, screen time and stuff. But I just hate seeing people struggle with that and miss out on opportunity because they can't get rid of that bias.
You know what it comes from? I honestly think, like, because most of those people are long bias. Like, I see a bunch of people, like, if it gaps down, oh it's going to fill this gap.
Yeah.
A bunch of these people are long bias. It's because everyone yelled buy the dip for, like, a year straight. And now everyone who's, like, been trading for only that year thinks buy the dip is, like, a normal thing. They think, like, buy the dip. That's not a normal thing. Like, until 2020, that was not normal. Like, every year before then that I traded, people were not constantly, like, buying the dip. They were looking for setups. Mm-hmm. Got to look for setups. It's not just buy the dip every single time. Dips keep dipping sometimes. Like, go look at, like, any of these
wish.
Small caps that...
Wish.
Go look at Wish. Go look at Clover, Clove. Go look at all those. Go look at AMC well. Since the pop. All those. Dips keep dipping sometimes.
I forgot. Yeah. I just posted a video. It was from... Let me go look. It was from Peter Lynch. He talks. Did I talk about this story? Peter Lynch talks about how he ran, I think, Fidelity or something, and he bought some stock. It was like $16, and he was a little bit newer into running Fidelity, and he's like, oh, it was just 32, now it's 16, how much lower can it go? And he loads up on it. Like, he said it was like one of the biggest placed orders in the market at that time, the history of the market.
Wow.
And it went down to $4, $3, $2 because in his mind he's like, it can't go any lower. And I was talking about this on stream with, like, SoFi's, your DraftKings, your PLTRs, like popular names that people thought they were steals at $20, $25. Now they're $8, $7. You can't have that freaking mindset, or you're just gonna get murdered.
That's one of the setups that beginners get caught in.
Honestly,
the biggest thing too is look for setups that are not retail heavy. Like, retail heavy setups, as much as, you know, people are going to call this, like, oh, it's a conspiracy, all that kind of stuff, they do get targeted by people with way more money than any retail traders. Like, they want to push you out. Sabby, that's a big name. He knows retail tickers. Yeah. He's going to be on retail tickers' ass. He's going to be riding them into the ground because he knows he can control them. He knows he can shake their hands out. He knows he can make them stop loss out, all that kind of stuff. And there's a bunch more other big money like that. So Just don't be in the things that are like the Wish, where it was Wish to 69 and then now it's Wish to actually 69 cents instead.
That was a good one. Yeah, nice. I do not trade crowded tickers small cap wise. I avoid them. I avoid the main runners really, unless there's like a good opportunity. And I don't really, if I see too many people are in it, I generally am avoiding or will look to get out just because those crowded plays just never work.
or getting in those before they get, you know.
Yeah.
Before they get crowded, that's when you
I like to get in early.
That's why that's when you can make right
serious
now,
money.
Yeah. Yep.
That's my biggest reason I'm in FAMI. I was telling people in my Discord is because we're in before it gets crowded. I feel like this one could get crowded. It's 15 cents, like 13 cents actually. Mm-hmm. It's like a Chinese name that like people love to talk about on Twitter. I think it could get one of those where people start to just like go hard on it. Those cheap ones, people are starting to pick them up. Big names are starting to pick them up.
Cheap is attractive too to a lot of people.
Yeah. FAMI could get that like Mullen type run, that piece of garbage, MULM. On full meme.
Terrible companies get more meme runs than I've ever seen. Like, why not run a good company? Why are we not running like something that's actually a decent company? Like SoFi, I think is a decent company. Like, why are we not running the shit out of SoFi? Why are we choosing AMC, a dying like movie theater? Or Mullen,
I just saw somebody on Twitter said that they're buying AMC and as long as it's under 500K.
You guys
Because they said I just retweeted it.
That's disgusting.
They said that they want to see 500K a share.
Yeah, dude. Like they said that there's infinite possibility. I said, bro, what? What are you talking about?
Because AMC just invested in gold mines, dude. Did you see that?
They invested in a penny stock that was like 30 cents a week ago.
It's garbage. It's a former SPAC. They haven't done anything.
They're terrible.
It's a
terrible company.
I was going to slap HYMC so hard yesterday at right when the news came out, and then it didn't do anything, and then I went back to sleep, and then I woke up. It was at 3. Well, shit.
Weren't you on that last week?
I played. I was on that. Like, I think like when it was like 30 or 40 cents and I played it, but I only got like a 10th of a position. Like I got like so small that it didn't even like impact my account. And then I woke up one day, it was up 90%.
Yeah.
And like it didn't even impact my account, even though it was up 90%. Like it was like such a small part that it like just didn't do anything. But
yeah.
Yeah. I was playing PLM last week, and it was the other one that gapped up with HYMC, but I sold it right before close, and then it gapped up almost 100%. I was so pissed.
I used to have a boner over PLM. Because, dude, they're going to supply – they actually are going to supply nickel to Tesla.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm 100% certain of that because they got that Glencore contract. Tesla's got Glencore.
Yeah.
It's just – no, like they haven't come out and said, like, this is where we're getting our nickel. So, like, nothing's happened, but – PLM, like, they could honestly, I don't know, people in Minnesota, I talked to a few guys in Minnesota who, like, live near the mine, and they don't think it's actually going to be able to, like, begin mining, but, dude, they've done well on their court cases. They're, like, actually 100%. I think they're, like, might be 90%, where they've won 90%. They got the water one. They got all this stuff. So, like,
yeah,
PLM, like, they could actually begin mining for Tesla, which would be crazy.
That would be nuts. I guess we'll see that transpire.
That'll be like years. That'll be years
in
the future. But all right, Barnable, we want to do kind of a quick little like a rapid fire where we just want to get to ask you a few questions here. It's going to be like food, stuff like that. So Barnable, what's your favorite food?
I would go with, I really like prime rib. Prime rib steak, prime rib with some horseradish less.
Thank goodness you said that. That's the way to do it.
That's a sleeper pick, but it's one of my favorites, so I'm gonna go with that.
Prime ribs fire.
Yeah,
Tony, if you had to give a favorite food, what would you say?
Pasta.
But what specific pasta? You gotta choose one.
Manicotti.
That big one.
Do you know what manicotti is?
Is that the fat one where you like put stuff in?
They're like the tubes. You fill it with like ricotta and cheese and stuff like that. And then that's my favorite.
Dude, I'd do a hamburger. I feel like lame now, but I just do a burger. But
burgers are good, but
yeah,
I can do a whole bunch of stuff with a burger. I can add some shit on there, you know.
Give me some Shake Shack and I'll be good.
Ooh, Shake Shack is good. All right, Barnabas, what's your favorite place on earth?
Favorite place on earth? I'm gonna go with Cabo San Lucas, in Mexico. I got married there a year ago. We're going back for our anniversary in 3 weeks. We went there. My wife and I have gone there like 5 or 6 times since we've been together.
That'll be fun.
Special awesome, place. Dude. That's freaking, dude. Cabo San Lucas. That would be. Oh my! I might have to get a resort there one of these months.
It's
fun. Take a little trip out there.
It's so nice.
Is the water really clear there?
It's not that clear there. It's Pacific side. If you want to get the clear water, you go to Cancun. But it's like desert mountains, but it's beautiful. It's fantastic. I love it. And good party scene too, if you're wanted to do that. But we just go to the resorts and kind of just lay around and relax.
That's awesome. Get some sun. Wait.
Yeah.
What's your favorite trading ticker?
Oh man, it used to trading ticker. So Chan. I guess I'll go. I used to love trading. It's a shitty name, but NXTD was one of my favorites.
Did you ever trade Jan?
Yeah. That thing was had some moves today. Somebody was pushing it.
Jan?
Yeah.
That used to be my favorite.
Girl Jan?
That used to be my favorite thing to trade. I'm not even.
Yeah, somebody was pushing it today and it got.
Oh. And we missed it.
Me and Tony used to trade that every single day.
I would, yeah, we would legitimately trade that 3 times a day for like 6 months every single day.
It's a fun one. The low floats. I love the low floats sometimes.
Yeah.
But other than that, this recent IPO, I really like DBGI. I've done really well on that one. So.
Oh, dude, I like that company long term, actually.
It's interesting. Based out of Texas, too. But yeah.
What do they do?
It's like clothing online. Stuff. It's interesting.
Wait. Say the ticker again.
DBGI.
Okay, never mind. That wasn't what I was thinking.
It's not. Sorry. It's just a. It's a. It's 4 letters for me, and I've done well on it. So.
There was that children's clothing line that got pumped a couple weeks. Yeah, hey. That.
Yeah. That one had a sick day today too. I don't know who was on it.
Dude.
Kid Pick Corporation is the name of that. Yeah. It did have a sick day. You're right. Yeah, it ran from 140 or 150 to 190, almost $2.
Yeah, that was a cool one. I was watching it. I was like, why didn't I join this? I don't know who was on it, but it was crazy. Good setup. But I like all small cap tickers. I've done well with Pola too, POLA. That one's been a big winner for me this year. I guess it went from like 3 to 6 last week, and I was on it early.
Trying to think of what I used to trade over the summer. I can't remember.
We traded Jan. We traded GBR a ton.
GBR.
GBR is fun.
Trading CEI, AEI.
AEI, that
shorted the punk fuck of trash. Out of CEI.
Yeah. What else? I don't know. I don't remember.
I do like
Go ahead.
I like to trade some of the beat up D-SPACs too. I think those are easy and liquid, and they have options. Yeah, they are. So. When they go,
they do have options. Those are nice to trade when they get down to like when they're like below $5.
Oh yeah,
those things will like you'll get like those random pops. You can see them coming, which is really nice.
Yeah, BFly today had a 500K form 4 that came out last night, and then it went from like 4.6 to like 5+. Yeah, I didn't trade it, but I was watching it.
Jivo, traded Jivo all the time.
AMTX,
yeah.
Oh man, those were big winners back in the day. Yeah. That's kind of that's like the glory.
It's nostalgia.
We're kind of reflecting. Yeah. Holy crap. Dude. It's weird to think we've been doing this podcast and like trading together for that long that we can have like a nostalgia. We can like think back.
Y'all been doing this since the summer?
Yeah.
Or last summer?
Since May.
Probably a year now. I think. Yeah, almost a year.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
28 episodes.
28 in? Around. It's probably like 30 because there was a couple there that weren't numbered. So,
yeah, we skipped a couple months, took a little break, but now we're back. All right, Barnabas. Next question: what's your favorite drink? You can go alcoholic, you can go non-alcoholic, whatever you feel like.
Favorite drink? Probably. I've been on a martini kick recently. for some reason, but I love my old fashions too.
Everybody in the old fashions.
Yeah. Old fashions are good.
No, yeah, they are. You got it. I just want somebody to say Moscow Mule one time.
I love Moscow Mules.
Well, okay, we'll take that. Take that. And you just got a mug, Moscow's Teddy. You just got a mug too. You can make them.
I just coffee tried mug. One. Did you see me drinking it earlier?
Was that what that was?
That's what that was. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't have one.
I was drinking. I had a Moscow Mule. It was like a cucumber Moscow Mule back in my college good. Town. And I like tequila. Yeah, those are good too. All right, band. Your favorite band.
My favorite bands, hands down. Have you guys heard of Rufus Du Sol?
Nope.
It's like EDM kind of, but like tropical EDM.
You know who'd like you know who'd like that? Dr. Bull Shark.
It's a Bull.
Dude, Bull Shark would be like banging.
He'd love that shit.
Yeah, they're, nah,
dude,
they're
I'm gonna have to look this up. What's the name again? I'm gonna write it down.
Rufus Du Sol. R U F U S D U S O L. I don't know if you guys know Ariel. Real Simple Ariel. He's a big fan of him too. Talk about
oh
him.
yeah.
I'm flying out to Washington to see Rufus in October. Saw him in Dallas recently.
Sweet. I like new music. I like new genres of music and stuff also, I haven't tried before. So
also MGK. I'm a diehard MGK fan.
You like his new stuff?
Seen him in concert.
We went to. I saw him in Dallas in October for his Tickets to My Downfall tour.
I've seen him twice. I haven't seen him since he like did the whole like little rock transition.
It's fun.
But yeah, I think his rock stuff would be way more fun than his old rap stuff. Yeah.
I mean, it brings me back to my childhood, like his like Blink-182-esque type stuff. I'm like, oh,
yeah. He gets those like Travis Barker type stuff going on.
Yeah.
All right. You got a favorite car? That's the last one.
Yeah. I really like, I don't have one, but I really like Land Rover Defenders. That's just like I drive a new Tahoe right now, but I was looking into the Defenders, but these were, thought it was just more practical. But I like those a lot, but I do, I mean, obviously sports cars, I want something cool eventually, but
yeah, fun car.
So do I.
Yeah. Fun car. Then yeah. Ways down the road.
I'll get one that can drive hella fast. Just like pop up to like 150.
All sports cars drive fast.
Hey, but I've never been in a fast car. I've never, dude, in Iowa, we don't got fast cars. True. You know what I'm saying, Tony?
True.
Oh, no, I don't know. I just want one that can like, I can punch that pedal.
I want an Audi RS7. That's my dream car.
Ooh,
that's a good one.
They're beautiful.
I saw one of those by my house like a week or two ago.
Yeah,
it was brand new. It had the license plate from the dealer on.
I looked at getting one, and there was none around me, so I had to like go searching, and the cheapest one I could find, because I wanted a new one, and the cheapest one I could find was like 150K. I'm like, yeah, nope.
Oh, wow.
No thanks.
Yeah, not yet.
No.
After some more trading.
Yeah, that's a whole house.
I want to snag one of them new Broncos.
Oh, those are beautiful, too. The sport ones are cool.
The lifted ones, not the base ones. The base ones are gross.
Yeah,
the
base ones are, yeah.
Gotta get that lift. Gotta get those black rims on them.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Last question for you, Barnum. This is the one.
This is the most important one.
This is the most important one. This is the one that I kind of think of all day and I'm the most excited about. So, what famous person would you want to battle gladiator style? Like in a ring in front of like cheering fans and togas. And you get like a sword and you have to either die or escape or, you know, kill them and get out.
Well, I was actually thinking about this. I have a couple. There's a couple options. I'm not a fighter, but I right now it would be Putin. One. I think that's a good one. That one would be good, and I would try to kick his ass. But it would be kind of interesting to fight like a Jack Reacher or John Wick kind of guy, and then but like not have to die. Just to, like...
it'd be like 1 second long.
Yeah. I know.
That's dude, funny. What would you do if Putin like just ran at you and like cracked your skull? Just like did some crazy ass like kung fu.
He's like a black belt.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
but
shit. Putin's legit.
Yeah, yeah, legit psychopath.
The black belt just because he was Putin, though. They're like, they took it from him. The black belt.
They took it from him with all these sanctions. I saw that they fucking removed his black belt.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah, I'm serious.
they took his black belt?
Yeah, they took it. That's
awesome. They're like, you've been debelted, bitch.
Yeah. Like, I'll take that back.
Hilarious. Tony, who would you fight? Who would you gladiator battle?
Oh, to the death. Probably Tucker Carlson.
That guy's annoying.
Do you know who that is? He's super, super annoying.
He
don't know.
He just talks.
Like a celeb celeb?
I'm looking up mine right now just to see how tall he is, so I know that I probably won't die.
Who would you fight?
Oh, good, he's 5'7". Dude, I would absolutely slice up Pitbull. I can't stand Pitbull, bro.
Damn. Why?
Mr. Worldwide. I would straight up like sword that motherfucker, like long sword.
Pitbull, Jesus.
Off the top of my... Sorry, Pitbull. I just don't like any of his music. My girlfriend knows if she wants to like piss me off when we're in the car or something, she'll play Pitbull, because like for some reason it just gets this reaction out of me. I'm just like, shut that the fuck off, like I hate Pitbull.
Unlock the door
so much.
You don't like Mr. Worldwide?
I can't stand it for some reason. This is his genre. It says rap dance hall pop.
Jesus.
That's how you know I'm just gonna hate it. Dance hall.
Yeah, dance hall pop. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a special place in my heart for Pitbull, and it's not a good place, but
that's funny.
That's who I would gladiator battle.
All right, Barnabal. Well, that brings us to the end. We want to thank you for popping on, giving us some solid information about you as a trader, and we'll have to have you on again in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd love to come on. Thank you guys for having me. It's awesome to meet you guys.
It was great meeting you.
Yeah.
Yeah, sounds good, man. Well, thank you everyone for tuning in, and baby, have a good night. You meet me by the beam? Too early, maybe later you could show me things. You know what it is whenever I visit Windy City. She blowing me kisses, no. 30 degrees, way too cold, so hold me tight. Will I see you at the show tonight? Will I see you at the show tonight?